Good morning. It's good to be with you on this chilly and windy morning. I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad I'm here. This week has been a tumultuous news week, hasn't it? More spiking in cases of COVID, both locally and globally, nationally as well. And political turmoil seems to be never ending. One thing we know for certain, despite the troubled times and the worrisome days, the frightening days, we know that God loves us. We know that nothing will ever change that. We know that that is a certainty. Maybe perhaps it's the only certainty we can fully depend on, is that we are loved and valued unconditionally. It's not often that I'm going to talk about a Saturday Night Live episode, but sometimes you find God in all places, strange places, but really all places. God, if we look hard enough, we find God is everywhere. And I'm always a week behind because I'm not going to stay up till 1 o'clock in the morning the night before Sunday. So I'm talking about last week, so a week ago. Dave Chappelle's monologue, if anybody saw that, was disturbing, poignant, important, and necessary. He talked about racism openly and frankly. He talked about wage disparity, other social issues. It's so crucial and important that comedy, even comedy, can be a change agent in our society. The musical guest was the band Foo Fighters, and when I heard that they were announced as the band, I was hoping that they would sing the song Times Like These because I thought it would be so relevant. And towards the end of the show, their last song was, in fact, Times Like These. And Dave Grohl, the singer, did an amazing job of singing the first half of the song, which is a raucous rock and roll anthem. He sang it a cappella. And he sang it with all his heart. And during the chorus, when he looked at the camera, which often they don't do when they perform on the show, looked right at us and sang the line, "It's time like these, times like these you learn to love again." So I'd like to begin, and I will also end the service with the words of the chorus from the song Times Like These by Foo Fighters. It's times like these you learn to live again. It's times like these you give and give again. It's times like these you learn to love again. It's times like these, time and time again. Welcome to worship, whether you're at home watching the service or those of you who are with us. I'm so glad that we're together. And I'm so glad that we can kindle the hope, the flame of hope that will never go out in each of our hearts. Collectively together, we are stronger and we are more hopeful. Our hearts and our voices united can bring change, the love of God to all situations, and the peace of God into tumultuous times. In times like these, we learn to love again. May God give us the strength and the hope and the courage to do so. All right, Jill, what announcements do you have for us today?
Yep, we had good news at our mission, retired ministers and missionaries offering. We already made our goal. We've raised $390, so that's really good. We're still going to be collecting. It's such an important mission, and it is our mission for the month. There are so many missionaries and ministers that have retired that don't have enough money, and a lot of times this goes out to help them. And they also give a gift to, you know, a lot of the ministers just as a gift. So it's really a good offering. Thank you. Sally thanked me last week for all the things that I do, and I really appreciate that. But you know, it takes a village. I may be the coordinator, but if you guys didn't do the things that I asked you to do, nothing would get done. Yes, that's right. Well, I just want to thank you, but I mean, it really does. You guys all help. Okay. The dinner is this Saturday. Pickup is from 5 to 6. If you haven't reserved your dinner, you need to do it by Wednesday. And when you call, you're going to be asked whether you want a pumpkin dessert or an apple dessert. So if you leave a message on my answer machine, if you give that detail, that helps me. If you are making a cake for the dinner, please be sure to have it at the church at least by 3 o'clock. If you're cooking a turkey, it needs to be there, a cooked turkey, by noon on Saturday so that we have time to pick it. We're peeling potatoes at 12:30 on Friday. So anybody who'd like to come and do that, it's 100 pounds is a lot. It took us a long time last time. We're collecting mittens and gloves for toddlers this month as well. A lot of the moms that come in, I can take this off. A lot of the moms that come in are looking for that now because it's starting to get cold. Okay. Now, this is my start for my video. I made a sign. I have my Christmas sweatshirt on. So I'm hoping that you'll do this too. It's not super hard. Okay. Sherry has an announcement too.
So December's mission is traditionally is the Heifer Project through Heifer International, and we have always, or at least since I've been in the church, which is not really much of always, but it feels like it to me. We have had the youth choose what animals we are working towards, and we want to keep that going. So in the online Sunday school lesson this week and next week, you're at the very end, there's a poll, so you'll get to learn about the animals. We have three large animal choices. So we have a goat, sheep, or alpaca. So this week's Sunday school talks a little bit about the project, the Heifer Project itself, and tells a little bit about those three animals and the benefits of those three animals. And you'll get to, and then at the end there's a poll, you'll get to vote, and we'll see which large animal. Next week is going to be the small animal, which will be, the choices are ducks, honeybees, and a basket of hope, which are rabbits and chicks. So I hope you'll get on and vote. These 2 weeks, there's not two separate Sunday schools because it's all on the Heifer Project animals. And so when we get to at the start of Advent, it will go back to the two different age groups. So I hope you'll get on. And if you like Alton Brown, that's how it starts, because he did a fantastic introduction to what the Heifer Project does. So it's a very amusing little 3-minute intro. So hopefully your kids will enjoy and vote so we can see what animals that we will be working towards.
So I had a request that with the camera stuff, at some point, some of the folks that watch online were like, could you pan around to the congregation? And I was like, well, I'm going to ask them first. So not this week, but in the future, if you're like, please do not videotape me or my crazy children, or whatever, just let me know. And 6 feet away from me, obviously. But otherwise, I like to sort of pan around so it's not just like one stationary camera, you know, do some stuff. So I think like Betty Kinsman and some other folks were like, who are watching it from afar, would really like to see some of your faces or half of your faces. So anyway, but if that's not good for you, I will avoid you. That's easy.
Make sure everybody's masks are on all times. If we're gonna
do yes.
No coffee break, no
right. Yeah. Yeah. That's also super important. You can't like, if I were to go around and this goes to everybody, it's public, and we have one person not there, we don't want to be on the news like that. Okay.
Oh, thanks. No, you didn't. I've got it. So just one quick follow-up to Sherry's talk about Sunday school. If you are not receiving access to her wonderful Sunday school lessons that are really appropriate for all of us, please let Jill know, and she can let you know how to get the link to it. For those of you at home or those of you here, if you'd like to take a peek at the wonderful work that Sherry's doing for us, I would highly recommend it. I think it's really well worth your time taking a look at it. And like I said, it really is interesting and informative for anybody, not just for kids. So you might want to think about it, even if you don't have kids, taking a look at the work she's doing, and really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
All right, well, I thought I would mix it up a little bit today, and I didn't tell Jill, so I'm probably going to be on the naughty list, but she'll forgive me. And I'm going to do Open the Eyes of My Heart instead of what's listed in the bulletin. But I think that I would like a little bit of help from you guys in providing the percussion for this. So if you are on this side of the church, I'm going to ask you on beats 1 and 3 to pat your legs. So you're the bass drum right here, okay? And if you're on this side of the church, on beats 2 and 4, you guys are going to give a little clap. So it's going to go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1. Hey, Jenny, can you do the 2s and 4s over here? Stand up. Stand up. She better get it right.
Like I am standing.
No. So like, stand up right here, and these 2 and 4 are gonna have a little go. This is gonna be like a hard clap because eventually, you know, your hands start to hurt, right? If you're clapping too hard. So just give us a nice little thing, and you guys are gonna be right on the beat, and I'll try to help you guys out over here. Okay. All right. Let's see if this works. Never tried it before. Here we go. Go for it.
Joy of masks and glasses. Okay. Please join me in the call to worship. To you I lift up my eyes, O you who are enthroned in the heavens.
Our eyes look to the Lord, our God.
until he has mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, O Lord. Have mercy upon us, for we have had more than enough of contempt. Our soul has had more than its fill of the scorn of those who are at ease, of contempt of the proud. Join me in the morning prayer. You, O God, are our dwelling place from generation to generation, our shield from anguish and distress. You arm us as children of light with the hope of salvation, and you protect us by your love. Give us grace to build up and encourage one another as we seek wisdom and abundant life in the strength of your word and the assurance of your spirit. Amen.
Adjusted the schedule for this morning. Feels like it's all we ever do, right? Right now is adjust the schedule, but this makes a whole lot more sense here. We're going to do the children's time now. So, hold on one second because I have a question for you. Can anybody tell me what this is? A carton of milk. Awesome. So most cartons of milk have a date on them, right? This one says November 15th. So we're probably still okay. But has anyone ever reached for a carton of milk and gone to drink it and it not taste so good? What happened to the carton of milk? It expired. It got spoiled, right? So what can I do with expired milk? Is that all I can do? So if I don't use it, I lose it, right? Okay. So in the second reading today, when Reverend Rose goes to read the second reading, there is a man who gives people 5 talents, they call them. Now, I went to go look this up a bunch because I like to make sure that I'm using the words correctly, because I certainly don't have a degree in Greek or Latin or anything that, you know, that it was originally written in, to see what talents meant. And because, you know, it's really easy for us to read the word talents and think it's actual talents. I thought, well, that goes well with my children's time. Is that what it really means? And it's kind of unclear, because some people say that it is money that they're talking about, and some versions call it gold pieces. I'm sure that Reverend Rose will talk more about that later. I'm going to go with the talents, though, for now, because I think that's still the intention. It says that when the man was given talents and he went and used them, he came back with more talents. But when the man was given talents and he went and didn't use them, he lost them. Kind of like the milk. He couldn't even give back the stuff that he had because he couldn't find it. So that says to me that we're all given gifts. We're all giving talents. Sometimes it's financial. Sometimes we're good leaders. Sometimes we're good organizers. Sometimes we're musicians. everybody has something. Something that they're able to use to give back to their church, to their community, to give to other people. And when God gives us those talents and we use them, they multiply. We inspire other people to use their talents, right? Like when our church decided to do the dinners, right? We started with a couple of people helping, and then we got more and more and more people. And when we use our time and our talents to make other people's lives a little bit brighter, everybody's life gets brighter. Make sense? So don't waste your milk. Sometimes ours goes bad too. But use your talents so that you don't waste them, right? Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for all the things that you have given us, for all the talents that we possess. Thank you that they're all different so that we can encourage and support each other and help us to know how to use them to serve you, to serve our church and our community. Amen.
First reading today comes from 1 Thessalonians 5, verse 5, and then 8 through 11. For you are all children of light and children of the day. We are not of the night or the dark or of darkness. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober and put on the breastplate of faith and love. And for a helmet, the hope of salvation. For God has destined us not for wrath, but for obtaining salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing.
Thank you. I'm here this morning to share a few things with you about our current stewardship campaign. Now, first of all, a little bit about the nuts and bolts of the campaign. A while back, you should have received a mailing from Scott on behalf of the Stewardship Council containing a stewardship letter. You should also have received a percentage giving chart with a 10-2 budget and a pledge card, a nice yellow one, and an envelope to place that in. So that should all have been received. If for some reason you didn't get it, you can certainly let Jill know or can let me know, and we'll make sure that you get copies of this. Now, the thing that we had planned out was to have some stewardship moments and culminating with Commitment Sunday or Pledge Sunday on November 29th. Now, the first one was supposed to have been last Sunday, but we had a little communication problem, so that did not happen. So I guess I'm entitled to double up today. Well, maybe not. When it comes time to decide on the pledge, obviously it's an individual decision, and you have options that you know you can decide on. Would you want to make a one-time donation, a quarterly donation, monthly or weekly? Whatever is best suited to your particular situation. Now, some of you may be aware of this, but our church first gathered back in 1853. The cornerstone for our church building, it's on the corner out front here, was laid back in 1860. Now, below this 1860 date on the cornerstone, there's something written in Hebrew. And we were able to get someone to translate that for us. Actually, Don Lawrence's son, Jonathan Lawrence, translated this for us back in 1998. And it actually reads, "Let there be light," in Hebrew. Now, over the years, there have been many different views of how we should be as a church to make sure that this light of ours continues to be visible for all to see. And we've had to tackle many challenges, like fires and floods, to just keep the light on. But none of these calamities may have been as difficult to handle as the coronavirus pandemic we've had to deal with for most of 2020, and that we will continue to have to face for quite some time yet. So let me give you some personal thoughts with some help from people down here on stewardship. Now, stewardship is defined as the act of supervising or taking care of something. Now, if you look at the word, it's made up of two individual words, if you wish. Steward, which is the supervisor or caretaker, and ship, which is that something to be supervised or taken care of. Now, what if that thing that had to actually be taken care of is an actual ship? Now who? All right. We need an organizer here. Now, all you can answer this, now what if that thing that actually had to be taken care of was an actual ship, like we have Nessa holding down there? Who would be the steward? Who would be the steward on that ship?
God.
Well, it could be. I think most of us would look at, certainly that would be the captain of the ship and the crew of the ship that would be responsible for that. There you go. And let me now change the question for you, and let's go to the next one, and you guys can sit down for a minute. Now, what if the thing that had to be taken care of is the church? Our church. Who's the steward in that case? Well, some of you may say the steward would be maybe Reverend Rose. Some would say that it might be the stewardship committee. And some of you, maybe most of you, would say it's all of us. It's we. We the people who make up the congregation of the church. So, you can take a seat for just a minute there so you don't have to hold the sign up so long, but come back with the sign a little bit later. When COVID-19 shut everything down in March, I think there were a lot of anxiety, a lot of doubts, a lot of fear, and people were wondering, how are we actually going to survive financially as a church? What about our baby bank? We weren't able to have any of the fundraising events that we had for the baby bank. We weren't able to do diaper drives. Where will we get the income to keep the baby bank going? Well, what happened was that the church family and friends continued their support as before for the baby bank. And we learned that there were other sources out there. We were able to locate grants, and we found grants that gave us the money to continue the baby bank and actually be on sound footing well into next first part of next year. But then the amazing thing was that we as a church saw other avenues. Instead of fear, and some of you may remember hearing Keith Cooper's sermon when he filled in during the summer. He offered a sermon on "Do Not Be Afraid." And it talks about when the disciples were out in the boat, and Jesus came walking across the water towards them out in the boat. And they got terrified and said, "What the heck is going on here?" And he told them in no uncertain terms, "Do not be afraid." Well, Keith made the comment that one of the reasons we as a church should not be afraid is because we're all in the same boat. We are all in the same situation, and together we can work this out. Now, Wendy offered also some thoughts on her beliefs and what she was musing about in a service that she covered during the summer, and was entitled Choices. Now, what she basically asked was this question: if God has a plan for me, how can I have free choice? How can I choose? And she basically said, God's plan is exactly that, for me to have choices and to make choices. And if you look at our church, what we did, we reached out to the community and said, "We're doing okay. Are you doing okay? We can be of assistance." And we have a church community outreach fund which assists people with some financial help. If they're a little short on maybe paying the rent for the month, or maybe they're a little short on paying the gas bill or electric bill, yeah, we have been able to help out, and we actually have raised money from it for that purpose. And I think all of you know that we have had three very successful dinners, and we have the fourth one coming up this week, partly paid for by the church, the people, and partly paid for by grants that we have received from ABC USA, various affiliations with ABC USA. So our choice was, ask the church, Jenny. Ask the church, our choice was not to be afraid, but to reach out to others and share with others. Now, Keith said in his sermon, community is not just our church's hallmark, but our strength. And as you will read, those who receive the e-newsletter on a weekly basis, there are three things that are stated in there. It says, choose kindness. Choose kindness. It says, choose compassion. And it says, choose love. Now, if we make these our motto, not just, you know, for day to day, but week to week, in terms of how we behave as individuals, but also how we conduct ourselves as a church and think about the stewardship of the church, we will get through this together. And in addition to choosing kindness, compassion, and love, let me also suggest that you choose to make a pledge by filling out this card, sticking it in the envelope, mailing it into church, dropping it in the offering box, or taking it to the church office. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Sandy. Thank you. What celebrations and or concerns do you have to share with us this morning? Yes, Dick.
First of all, the call to worship was perfect. Fantastic to pray. And I think we should offer prayers for those who are content and the haters that they can find kindness and acceptance and the light of the Lord in their heart.
Thank you. It's hard to think about the wider world when we're consumed with politics in our country and the continuing rise in COVID cases here in this country, but the nation of Ethiopia is going through a terrible violence period, and our sisters and brothers over there who are caught in the crossfire and victims of undue and unnecessary violence need our prayers as well. All right, let us pray. Oh, Jill.
For Gordy,
thank you. Yes, Gordy is, if you don't know, Gordy's in the hospital and is recovering from an infection, not a COVID-related infection, a different one. All right, let us pray. Loving God, we bring our concerns and our celebrations to you as we do each week, trusting that you hear us, that you will be merciful, and in your wisdom and your mercy, hear our prayers. So this morning, we, as we do each week, continue to lift up to you all those in healthcare who are taking care of the sick and the needy and those who have lost loved ones, people working in funeral homes and bereavement counselors. So many professions affected by this pandemic. We think of the states in our country and the countries throughout the world whose hospitals are overflowing and at full capacity. Healthcare workers are burned out and tired out and had enough, and yet the sick keep coming. May we be united in our response to this pandemic. May we be as safe and careful as we possibly can, and may we adhere to science and understanding of how we can keep ourselves, our loved ones, and the wider world safe at this time. We are also thankful for those who continue to work in restaurants and convenience stores and gas stations and schools, the teachers' aides, people in grocery stores, who continue to do the work that is necessary to keep our society going, whether they do it virtually or in person, under difficult and strenuous circumstances. Please guide them and be with them. Give them hope and courage in these difficult times. We think specifically of our friends, our sisters or brothers, our family members at Absolute Care. The many who are working there and the residents there who've been diagnosed with COVID-19, we ask that you will help them to heal, help them to continue to be safe, to find ways to prevent this infection from spreading to others. Please watch over them and take good care of them. We pray for a nation so deeply divided over opinions and abstract ideas. May we not allow hatred to rule us, but may we allow sisterhood and brotherhood to seize the day and to remind us that we are all family, all God's children, regardless of what our opinions are or where we stand on issues. We are human beings, charged to take care of each other, to love each other, and to listen to each other. We think of the middle school and high school students in our community, and we ask that in these very difficult times in which they ought to be able to interact with their friends and to laugh and to play and to talk together, visit together, and get to know each other better and build on their friendships. And it's so hard at times like this. School is hard enough, but even maintaining friendships becomes so difficult. Please help parents who are trying to navigate this difficult situation, juggling work and school and internet issues and computer issues. Help all of those who are depressed and feel like giving up. Give us strength and courage. Please watch over our dear brother Gordy as he recovers from his infection in the hospital. Help him to heal and to regain his strength as soon as possible. We pray also for Joan Jacobs, who had surgery on Friday, and we ask that you will help her in her recovery and give her body strength to heal. We think also of our sisters and brothers in Ethiopia who are struggling amidst violence and warfare. May they, those who are at conflict with each other, soon find an end and restore peace, so that the citizens, the average people, who are just trying to live out their life, can do so in peace and harmony with each other. Loving God, to you we lift up these prayers. We ask for your wisdom and your courage and your strength. And now as we unite our voices and our hearts to pray the prayer which Jesus taught us to pray, please speak through us and with us as we pray now. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It's actually in your green hymnal. It's 587, Make Me a Channel of Your Peace. And I just popped into my head this morning. But it's also the prayer of St. Francis. When I was in Italy a number of years ago, one of my favorite spots was in Assisi, where Francis was from. And we saw his tomb. And I'm going to play. So the words are, make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord, and when there is doubt, true faith in you. Master, grant that I may never seek so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, and to be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is despair in life, let me bring hope. Where there is darkness, only light, and when there is sadness, ever joy. And now I will try to play it in the right key.
Loving God, thank you for the gifts, the tithes, and the offerings that sustain this loving church. May you bless those that give in the many ways in which these good people give, with their heart, with their hands, with their voices, with their actions. And may you bless our endeavors, both now and into the future. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our gospel reading for this morning comes to us from the 25th chapter of Matthew, and we'll be looking at verses 14 through 30. So Jesus is speaking here, and he begins by saying, "For it is as if." And the first question that may come to mind is, what is as if? And he is speaking of the kingdom of heaven, as is noted in the first verse of chapter 25. "For it is as if a man, going on a journey, summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1. Each one according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled the accounts with them. The one who would receive 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I've made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' And the one with 2 talents also came forward, saying, 'Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master.' Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, 'Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours.' But the master replied, 'You wicked and lazy slave. You knew, did you, that I reap where I do not sow and gather where I do not scatter? You ought to have invested the money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." Ruby Bridges. Say that name with me, please. Ruby Bridges. 60 years ago yesterday, November 14th, 1960, Ruby Bridges went to school, a new school. She was 6 years old. She went for the first time to a new school. Seems like an ordinary act. Well, not today, but back in 1960, seems like a normal thing for a kid to do, a 6-year-old girl to go to school, a beautiful, glowing, optimistic, and hopeful 6-year-old girl who had no idea what was to become of the act of going to school. Perhaps you noticed upon coming in this morning that another one of our rainbow flags has been ripped off our railing. It's the second one in just a couple of weeks, first one on Halloween night. Somebody, somewhere, is upset. and feels this is the best way to express their frustration. Well, they won't hamper our efforts to be a light in the community. We'll just keep putting the flags back up. And thanks to Jill and Evan and Sandy and Donna Lynn, the first flag went right back up almost immediately. And likewise, the next one will follow. We won't be daunted by acts of spineless violence. We have a message to proclaim of equality and love and inclusion and acceptance. We will proudly proclaim that despite someone's efforts to silence us. I have a sign in front of my house that says Black Lives Matter. I've had one there for quite some time. I went to seminary. I was fortunate enough to go to a seminary in which I was in the minority, both as a Baptist and as a white man. The majority of my fellow students were African-American men and women, and people of other races, and people of all different denominations. And it was humbling and honoring to be amongst such brilliant minds, powerful spirits, and people who have gone on to do amazing things. One of my classmates, Andre Spivey, is a city councilman.